My thoughts about the jails have been ongoing since I've been elected, and in my past experiences as a commander, I was in command of 3 jails. My desire was to repurpose the jails and its culture in order to repurpose the lives of men and women who have offended. This is one of the greater aspects of a failed prison and jail system throughout the United States. And my ideals of repurposing the jails is that every person in jail should have an opportunity for education that will assist them in developing themselves into a more effective human being without committing crimes. This has been launched, and I'll talk about it in a while. But let's get to what has happened in the past year since October 1st of last year till now. What has happened in the wake of my being presented by the ACLU with a series of allegations regarding use of force in the jails by deputies. In order for me to do a complete and thorough audit of jail operations, the first element of change has to be listening to where all the problems are and what can you do to address them from the viewpoint of the stakeholders. So numerous inmates have been met with me and my jail commanders, and to date, because we cycle 140,000 individuals in and out of this jail per year, we have listened to 53,000 inmates in total. This is a weekly cultural shift in the jail so that we can understand better how to live up to our constitutional obligations. At the same time, we met with hundreds of deputies, particularly those who've been involved in use of force, to solicit from them the causal factors and what we could do to help prevent force. With their assistance, we were able to establish a force prevention policy that is the first in the nation in any jail or prison. At the same time, we consulted with outside entities that are also stakeholders, such as the Board of Supervisors, the Office of Independent Review, Special Counsel Merrick Bob, the Department of Justice, the Department of Mental Health, the American Civil Liberties Union, certainly the Citizens Jail Commission, and various community advocates, including hundreds of clerics who have been instrumental in coming into the jail to assist us. All of that is in this chart. Now, these charts will be set aside, and we will ask that you, if you want to have more thorough review of the charts, then we'll move forward in that regard. Now, inmate relations. Commander Fennell, who I introduced you to, is the man in charge of inmate relations. I formed this special command unit because I wanted to cut through the bureaucracy. And I will say, since I've been elected in 1998, my biggest job and challenge is to make sure the bureaucracy does not get in the way of effective communication. But as bureaucracies will be, that has happened and perhaps may continue in certain occasions. But it's certainly not something that I'm happy about. But with inmate relations, we believe that the relationship between a deputy and an inmate should always be respectful. Thus, we've had the town hall meetings. And one of my captains earlier in a pre-meeting to this meeting, and I'd like you to stand up. Captain Nunes, can you stand up for a moment? He said, it takes a village to raise a child, but it also takes a village to turn the life of an inmate around to be a crime-free life. Thank you very much. That is a very wise way of looking at what our repurposing is, that we have to work together in this jail to accomplish the more noble goal of saving the taxpayers' dollars, in the sense that if a person has been repurposed, rehabilitated, and reentered, then they won't come back. But that cannot be done if jails are always going to be punitive. There has to be a balancing point, and I've been a passionate advocate for that for years and years and years, but it takes time. So now we have 6,000 plus inmates in classrooms 5 days a week. This has reduced the anxieties between deputies and inmates, and it's deputies and professional teachers who are actually instructing the inmates, in addition to inmates who have now become part of a mentoring process for other inmates. And this allows us to capitalize on some of the talents of the inmates themselves. So in effect, what we've done is we've created a learning institution at the same time that we've reduced the force. Now further, to advance ourselves, and we'll move off that chart to the next one, the three cornerstones of change involve policy, supervision, and training. And we definitely had to improve in those areas. So I mentioned the force prevention policy. But at the same time, when you are using force in the jails, the deputies needed to have a more appropriate way of using force that would not result in injury or pain. So we have thus gone through a complete conversion as to how we're going to use force in the jail when it's necessary. And at the same time, there's a list of things that the jail commission has provided us, as you know, last week. And I will mention that in conclusion of these remarks. But the key is that there's many ways to approach a problem, and we have looked at 16 different ways to improve our policy, and I'm just indicating to you what those ways are here. The supervision, there's another reality there that has to be improved upon, and we've looked at what kind of training we want to provide, and we want to stabilize that supervisorial element because it is critical to how we succeed. The third point is the training. There's a need for us to constantly re-examine what our training messages are. The objective here is simple, that humanity and violence are incongruent. It is not humane under any circumstance for any of us to think violence is ultimately going to solve anything. It doesn't. All it does is it establishes more concern and it causes harm on both sides, the deputies and the inmates. So the culture in the jail, through education and the environment of communication and policy and better supervision and ways of understanding what does it mean to be an inmate. And in my conversations with them, there is a challenge. There's depression, there's anxiety, there's stress. There are things that are fundamentally human to anyone if they were incarcerated. We want to better understand what we can do to take that pressure and apply it in a positive way. Thus, education-based incarceration, appropriate inmate to deputy communications, that we believe in the constitutionality of our jail operations, and that we think that procedural justice, whether it's in the community at large or here, that there's a right way to do things as opposed to a wrong way to do things. Now let's go to where this point and ideology that I've mentioned to you has taken us. What has taken us from the beginning of October 1st to today is that the significant force, that is force that involves pain or injury, has dropped 53% in 1 year. It is an historic low. It is the lowest in the nation when it comes to any major jail. Now that doesn't mean we're through. That means that we're at a new threshold where we're able to say that the strategy of engaging dialogue with inmates, listening to their advice, listening to the deputy's advice, changing policies, enhancing supervision, better training, and having a sense of the village that was alluded to by the captain who's in charge of a major jail, that this is how you get a better response from the authority figures and a better response from those who are here awaiting trial and serving sentences. So this is really one of the major stories of this press conference. And I'm very, very grateful that the men and women of the Sheriff's Department, through the core values, through our leadership, have responded massively to bring about those results. Now we do have plans for future success. and that is, we want to increase our supervision in the jails. We want to have a stronger inspectional command ability, and we now have that. We want to restructure some of our command positions, and we certainly want to create a training bureau that has its command here in the jails, because the jail is a unique place, and you can't apply force here in the way that you would think you would anywhere in the system. It really is a unique place, and our theory is better to prevent it than to have to use it. So that takes additional training. We also want to increase our internal affairs investigators. We certainly want more body scanners, and there are issues regarding our budget, but I will say this. If I have to do all these modifications with the money that I have that's very, very at limit, I'm going to do it. I cannot afford to wait for long budget deliberations over whether I can do this or not. I'm going to have to just move resources, as I've always had, to get this job done. It's that important to me. But let's get to the jail commission's report. I agree with every recommendation that the jail commission has provided, not only me, but the board of supervisors. And let me tell you why. This commission was formed as an idea between me and Supervisor Xavier Soski. And I appreciated that dialogue at that crucial time. I wanted this commission as much as the board did. I wanted it for the sake of clarity that ideas to change the organization are not all going to come from within. That there are others that may know something more than I do, and I'm open to this. The point then is that when I read the recommendations, I couldn't have written them better myself. That's how impressed I was with the level of thoughtfulness that's in those recommendations. And I know that when they're fully implemented, we will be a stronger and safer jail. And let me say this to the inmates who are seated behind you. You gentlemen are here for a variety of reasons that I know have caused a lot of challenge for you. But I also believe that you can turn your life around. And the men and women of the Los Angeles County, so with that, we're joining with you. So in conclusion, let's talk about the final point of some of the restructuring. We had two divisional chiefs before all of the ACLU reports came forward. I consolidated to one, and there was a very important reason for that, that the two had separate responsibilities. One was for the security, and the other one was for the inmate services. This caused a little difficulty in effectiveness. In fact, in certain cases, a lot of difficulty. By having it under Chief Yim, who fully believes in what I'm saying here along with all the jail commanders, I'm able now to have a more effective and direct line of control. Make no mistake about it, control is necessary. So this division, with Assistant Sheriff Rambo, who you've met, and the custody division chief having a lot of power, and the operations commanders helping, you have all of these jail commanders and inspectional commanders overlooking things so that we're not falling through the cracks with information, good, bad, or ugly. Now, let's get to the end here. This is the organizational chart. Now, there is some questions I'm sure somebody wants to ask about the undersheriff. Well, let me tell you this. The undersheriff position is kind of a misunderstood position in certain respects. When I hired in here, Sheriff Pitches had undersheriff who wasn't even sworn. This was a man who never wore a badge and never carried a gun. But he was the assistant to the sheriff. And he did all of the administrative things that the sheriff needed done to make sure that we weren't a black hole of paperwork. And let me say this about my time on duty. I worked 70 hours a week I do most of it in the office, but I have a lot of public accountability. And I believe the public is the first source of my accountability, but so is the board, so is all the commissioners, the Office of Independent Review, Merrick Bob. I don't believe that accountability is purely something that's on the definition of being elected. I believe that accountability is that you share what the methods and concerns and input that the public has as to how are things going. So, the assistant sheriff, or the undersheriff, I should say, is a position that does the sheriff's detail work. So, I can say this about Mr. Tanaka without question. As a CPA, when my budget was overrun in the early 2000 and $25 million to the red, I removed the budget director at that time and put Mr. Tanaka in there because he's a CPA, he knows money. And I said, I don't want this to ever happen again. It's not only embarrassing, but it's really inappropriate for the sake of the taxpayers. But we're going to pay it back to the county. So the following year, we saved $25 million through scratching and putting things together and doing things to save that $25 million, to give it back to the county. And therefore, we squared away that debt. Now, when it comes to Mr. Tanaka's involvement with the current budget, we went from a $1,400 million budget to a $2.6 billion budget in the ensuing years. I cannot afford to misspend the taxpayers' dollars. So what I've decided, for the sake of clearing up some of the allegations a little, I'm going to investigate them, but I want him to continue to manage the department's budget. The undersheriff has never been in control of operating units. The direct reports to me are the assistant sheriffs and the division chiefs. And I meet with the division chiefs every week along with the assistant sheriff and the undersheriff. This has been a practice that I've done and my predecessors has done. We talk to each other. Now, as you know, I've stated publicly that if you don't tell me the bad news, that I don't have the authority to exercise my options in how to correct the bad news. And so I've had some gaps there. But in order for the public to understand, I've addressed those gaps. All of this reduction of force, the change of the environment in this jail, this is at my involvement and direction, make no mistake about it. But I do believe that the ACLU has done me more good than harm. I don't lead with my ego. I lead with my intellect. I want you to know that. I want you to know that I'm a passionate believer in the public's right to be properly treated, whether they're in jail or out of jail. And I will continue to pursue the improvement of this great organization because I think it's the right thing to do. So that is my briefing, and I hope that there are some questions that you might find that I can answer to be more clear.
Sheriff, on the topic of Tanaka.
Yes, sir.
Is he gone, fired, out of the picture, what?
Well, let me say this about that. We believe in core values, and we believe in procedural justice, not for the public only, but for ourselves. I'm looking into the pros and cons of the allegations, and I've been hearing a lot of opposite statements about the very same allegations. And so the OIR and our internal affairs will have to sort it out for me so I can be real clear. But I am not a person that acts impulsively or in my own self-interest when it comes to someone else's career. We'll either have the facts or we won't have the facts. But that's what I have to do because it is not fair. And we do believe that evidence and facts drives disciplinary decisions, not allegations.
So where is he now? What's his
point? I just explained it. He is my assistant over the administrative and budgetary matters. As you can see, every other assistant sheriff is coordinating and directing, directly reporting to me, the operations. That is the recommendation of the commission, and I follow it.
Sheriff, is that a change then for the undersheriff position?
Not really, because I said earlier that I am the sheriff. There is no undersheriff running the organization. I am. I think the misunderstanding is that we're all together in our executive meetings and we examine our problems in a manner that has got everyone involved. I think that is the most appropriate way to run a big organization. And so everyone has a stake in what our decisions are, but make no mistake, I'm the guy that makes the decision. Yeah, the organizational chart generally has been where you put the undersheriff right below the sheriff, but that's kind of a misnomer in terms of effect and authority. So I had revised the chart to really establish that I'm the one who's calling the shots and that we don't have another person that's somewhat operating out of my influence. That's the impression I think that some people have had in the organization. And I think that's the impression that's been put out in the media as well. No, he is my assistant. That's what the undersheriff means. I'm in command of the department. There is no number two. The assistant sheriffs work directly with me. They're not commanding. They're assisting the command level people with me, and then I in turn direct through them what I want. And they look at some of the administrative practices and the training practices and the things that we can do better, and then they feed it through the system, and I meet with them once a week, and we put it into action when it's recommended.
Sheriff, he's not here today. Is there a reason why he's not here?
Well, he's at the State Sheriff's Association. And let me say this. I'm on the Board of State and Community Corrections. The governor and I have a similar vision, and he and I have talked significantly about what I'm talking about when I say education is necessary for people to turn their lives around. And so I'm in the business of trying to help the state prison system do what we're doing here. So Mr. Tanaka is up there on my behalf, and this is what I'm talking about, my assistant, representing me there. That job is to represent me, not himself, me. And I have to have a person to do that for me. There's just way too much interaction with officials, with associations, with the public, with things that go on in the department where I have to send somebody to go in and deal with it. And that's what he's doing right now.
Sheriff, change of subject. The very compelling numbers you presented about the reduction in force, were those statistics not available to the commission? How did they come to the conclusion that there is unwarranted force in the jail and there's this culture of violence against inmates?
Well, I think it's largely the byproduct of anecdotal resources. Now, I have testified to them privately, and I've told them, not the exact number, but that we had had this corollary strategy of changing the culture in the jails. And they were impressed, and my interviews with them were positive. At the same time, I think that the recommendations that they wrote are sensible, and they're like where my thought process is. But they had an obligation for public input, and so they did their best to assemble it, and they put it out in an uncensored way. But I just see that they needed a little more impetus because I am elected, I am independent, I account to everybody, including them. However, at the same time, I guess they thought I would implement the recommendations.
You know, I don't know. You'd have to ask them.
Sure.
Sheriff, who measured that 53%? And the commission said that they do believe they commended you for some of the reduction in force, but they said that the problems are not fixed.
Well, I didn't even say the problems are fixed. There's a reduction, and I'm saying to you that force will at some point get used in jails. You know, this is a human reality. You know, many of our deputies get attacked, all right? And then we have a situation where a third of the force are the inmates fighting with each other. Well, guess who has to go in there and break them up? Deputies have to do that. So the numbers are all tracked through our reporting mechanism, and we have very stringent rules on that. And as you know, we've been
putting cameras all over the place so that if someone disbelieves the deputy and what he did, we have a camera to back up or lay whatever that suspicion is.
Well, the commission also talked about your not so wonderful record keeping, especially when it came to support. Why should the public believe you when you say you documented 53%?
By coming in and examining the system themselves. You know, here's an interesting point. Since I've been your sheriff, I've opened up this jail many, many times for you. I've said, come on in. I say it to the public, my greatest critic. Come on in here and look for yourself. Because you see, words can be very explanatory and be totally false. It takes vision, it takes involvement, and it takes a little more examination. You see, back again to the criticism. I believe as elected official, you're here to be criticized. I'm not asking for no criticism. But I don't lead with my ego. The public and anybody can really attack hard if they want.
Sure,
you
made a comment.
You want to restructure the command position in the jail. Does that mean that the actual captains and commanders will be replaced? And there'll be different captain members?
Oh, no, this is a successful team. I mean, you got to remember that the individuals that are here running the jails, what they needed out of me, the ACO is correct, they needed me to get in there and set a higher standard for good performance. And I said, you got to meet with these inmates like I did. You got to meet with the deputies. You got to talk to people all the time because this is a social process. In fact, I was talking to Judge Goodwin Liu, the Associate Justice of our state Supreme Court this past weekend. And he and I think alike on the idea that when there's gaps of understanding between aspects of society, it's a socialization problem. And so what we've done is addressed this in that fashion, that the gap between deputies and inmates was too big. The inmates had no voice or small voice, and the deputies didn't know their obligation to listen. So then these captains get into the middle of it, and they start holding the town hall meetings like me. Then they know how to converse with their deputies about the inmates. And before you know it, that gap is closed.
And so that's where I think the value of the ACLU's criticism of me puts me in a place of finding an answer and not just saying, well, I don't like what you're saying. You know, it's a thing of acceptance and then response. And the output now is what we're describing here. These inmates, trust me, they're not interested in getting fights. Some are more designing some of this stuff if they're tied to a gang or something, and we do have that in here. But make no mistake about it, we even have Commander Petrotoni here. Would you stand up a moment? He got an Emmy guy. Now, Emmy is the greatest Mexican gang in California that has been shot calling a lot of disturbances in jails, including ours. But this man wanted to get out of his MA image, and he had a big tattoo on his forehead. And with our tattoo removing machine, he had the tattoo removed. Now that means great risk to him from the gang. But that's the influence that this education-based incarceration has had on turning this one MA member life away from the MA lifestyle. You see, and that's where the success has to be defined. One inmate at a time, one deputy at a time, and many changes from the commission, many changes from within, and we're not gonna give up on how we're gonna find an answer for everybody. Happened, how did it happen, and can we look for what this problem truly is? Defining a problem is easy when you blow it up as big as that I've been facing. But you see, I'm not fighting allegations. I will say this to you. If there was not any scintilla of unnecessary force in this jail by anyone, I'd still welcome the criticism. And I'll tell you why. Because you can still reduce force even if it's reasonable and necessary. That's where I'm coming from. I'm not here to quibble with the story was too ugly, too big, and too unfair. I am paid to take criticism even if it's unfair. You see, I believe in the nobility of policing. And the police nobility, in my point of view, is you don't fight with your community, even if your community fights with you. I'm not one to not serve. I'm not here for me. I'm here for the public. I'm here for you. I'm here for the media. I'm here for the ACLU. As a matter of fact, my record is clear. I brought forth the dilemma of the homeless crisis to a higher level when I first was elected. Now, a lot of things have been done, but we haven't fixed that. I brought forth the mentally ill issues because I was raised with a mentally ill uncle. I know the suffering of people. People will never be in a place where my heart is somewhere else except with their dilemmas and their challenges. That's who I am. So therefore, if I'm removed from office by the voters, which is their responsibility, then I'm still going to say thank you for the great opportunity that I've had. But the bottom line is, I lead with my intellect, not my ego or my emotions.
Corrections expert.
Yes.
Lockups.
Yes.
Somewhere else. Experience to run your jails.
Yes.
Will you do that?
Yes. We're looking at a couple, and I've talked to Brian. He's here somewhere. He's of counsel, and we're going to do that. And you see, the great thing about this opportunity.
That person will be the new assistant sheriff to. That's
the person that we're looking for. Now, I recommended that at the onset of all the allegations. I said, I need a third assistant sheriff that's going to be focused, who will be here in the jails, who will not be in the offices where I am. I want an online, visible person who's representing me here. And so when I come in, there's a seamless process where I'm flowing with my own mandates, and I'm being... The people are being accountable to me for whatever's going on in here. Yes. Joe Arpaio? Well, Joe Arpaio is a different man. He has different policies, different feelings. I don't know where the comparison even is because he doesn't say the things I'm saying to you. Well, we don't know all the costs. I mean, that's a big question. I appreciate you asking it, but it's a matter of evaluating all the options. Now, the board has got to make a decision in respect to your question. My job is to continue to do what I'm doing, and that's managing the jails. But let me make something very clear about what I'd like you to consider and how you assess this whole story today. If you miss the major point of educating these inmates, I don't care what institution you have, private or state or county, you're going to end up with the same failing recidivism problem that this nation and this state and this county has been plagued with too long. Now, either you really care about true reform or you just want to just report about how I am, you know, not doing this and not doing that. I've told you what I've done. I've accepted responsibility for the process moving in a direction that was unsuited for what I'm saying to you today. I put myself in the middle of it all like I should, and I take the blame for whatever's wrong. And now we have to just keep on being as successful as I've demonstrated. And we've got to still get you in here. I want you to do stories about these inmates. I want you to do stories about these deputies. I want you to do stories about things that are real to the public. that are not just the bad news.
Sheriff, you said that you accept the responsibilities you just said, but what's your message, what do you say to the deputies that are here and that day in, day out deal with all this? Probably don't really feel the way you do about the repurposing and are probably pretty jaded about it's a lost cause.
Well, please don't think for them. I mean, I appreciate the question, though. The deputies here, let's talk about what does it mean to teach an inmate? Most of the deputies here have never used force in their life.
They don't even know what it means to get in a fight with somebody on the street as a kid. They also don't know what it means to teach. You know, I'm only 25 years old. You're asking me to teach men in their 30s and 40s and 50s about life skills? Okay, well, the question then is, it's not so much you're teaching them as a younger person how to have life skills, you're teaching them principles that are backed up by other inmates' testimonies. And quite frankly, the inmates are teaching themselves. Once they get the core conversations going with the principles of living a positive life, then it's not just getting up and lecturing. It is engaging the dialogue appropriate to the individuals who are leading it. And it's really the deputies being facilitators of the inmates having these serious dialogues and trusting each other. You see, the tension here is from several sources. Most of the tension here is these inmates have never known each other before. So they're new to each other. So they have this protectiveness that they're engaged in. Then we're throwing the education process into this, where they then start to reveal needs that they have, and they start talking a dialogue that is very sensible, not just for them, but for us. Okay? And those core values are the cornerstone that you can tie to every kind of misconduct. If you don't have respect for the dignity of all people, you don't belong in this business. If you don't have common sense and fairness in what you do, you don't belong in this business. If you can't do what is right and fight what is wrong, I'm talking about fighting what is wrong. I'm not saying just watch what is wrong and you didn't do anything wrong, but you got to fight what is wrong to be a deputy sheriff. You cannot tolerate another deputy's bad behavior. And that has happened here. All right? And then this whole thing about societal harmony, you know, the courage, do you think we're talking about courage from our point of view? Yeah, it takes courage to go out and deal with inmates. It takes courage to protect the community when someone's robbing a bank and shooting at you. It takes courage. But let me tell you what takes more courage. To stand against racism, to stand against sexism, to stand against homophobia, to stand against anti-Semitism, to stand against bigotry. That takes more courage. Why? Because society is accustomed to separating itself. Under the greatest nation with the greatest laws, it's unacceptable for Americans to take other Americans and put them in categorical places of containment. That's like being in a jail, as far as I'm concerned. Jails are here. Jails are not in the community. But bigots create jails. And I'm one who's going to stand up for the American legal system no matter what.
Who said that they were the victims of excessive use of force inside the jails. How many of those have you found to be true?
Let's talk about 50, because we're still going through. I know that, but the first phase was about 70. That was the first group, and then later, months later, we got a second group. So we're, you know, as they keep on bringing them in, we look at it. But in the
first 50, we have two very serious revelations that we were able to discover with the help of their submitting those allegations to us. No, we look at them all, but you got to investigate them all. You see, you can look, but you see, let me make sure I'm clear. You got to go find these inmates, many of them, because the ACLU gave these cases to us a year after they knew about it and set them aside and then gave the bunch because it makes a package, as they say. We were able to recognize immediately that these prisoners are released and they're all over the country. and you've got to go find them and validate whether or not the allegations are true. We have found also that there are a certain number that the allegations were functionally not accurate because the inmate said, that's not what I said. So there's other issues involved in this.
Problem with deputy inmate violence inside the jails? Yeah, I do, in a sense that even if it's one doing it, it's persistent. You see, and what we really are talking about, when I take the commission's view, which I will at this point, that zero tolerance is what we're talking about. We cannot have one deputy going overboard with force, not one. And so that's where the goal is, and I think we're reaching that goal because of this dramatic drop in serious force. Now, the non-serious, when I say serious, I mean significant. Yes, I would like to get this, you're gonna go see, there's two parts of MCJ. This one, which is the old part that everyone talks about, and then the newer part on the other side. This one, I want to close and make all classrooms. All classrooms. The other side we'll use for housing. But this is too old, it's problematic, it's designed as flawed, you'll see it, and that's where we're going. All right, well, thank you, God bless you, thank you so much for your questions and your patience.